Hi, AT from CNC at Home. I wanted to go over a couple features within Lightburn that are relatively easy to use, yet I'm not sure everybody really understands them or utilizes them very well. If we look down here in my laser window or portion of the window, there are two tabs down here. There's a material library and an art library. If you don't have these, you can go into the Windows area and you can turn them on and off. Here's the art library, and down here is material library. You can turn those on. And you can move them around too. If you want them in a different windowy kind of thing, you can do that. This is where I have them, and I want to go over how they're used. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Let's start by talking about material library. As we'll notice here, my material library is empty. Normally it's quite full with all of the specific cut parameters and etch parameters for different types of material. It's information that I have collected using each one of my lasers with different materials. Once I figure out how it works well, I record it in my material library. I want to talk briefly about how that works. I'm not going to be giving away any secret information, as everybody's laser is going to work a little bit differently, and your preferences are going to be different than my preferences. Let's talk about how we create items. To put something in the library, we first have to create some sort of layer. I'm going to just create a rectangle. By default, we're at a fill. It has a certain power setting. If I double click on that, I can go in and manipulate this. I'm going to say I want 2,000 millimeters per minute at 25% power. I'm going to have an overscan. My line interval is 1. I like that in 1 pass. Let's say these are the settings that have worked for a specific kind of material, and I want to be able to call this up again next time I'm using this material. What we do is we click on the Create New From Layer. This is the layer that's selected. We say Create New, and it's going to ask for a material name. So I'm going to call it Stuff. If what we're doing is cutting through a particular material, we can turn thickness or turn the no thickness off and say how thick the material is. I'll show that in a little bit. Let's say what we've got is a parameter for etching. So the title of this, we have our stuff, and I'm going to call this etch. And maybe something more specific about stuff. Maybe it's blue is the color. So I'll call it etch blue. And then in the description, I can say something such as etch blue stuff. It can be whatever you want. Blute, blue. I can spell. When we click OK, now we started creating a hierarchy. We have our material stuff, we have etch blue, and then this is our parameter for doing that particular etch. I can also switch this layer to line. I could change its parameters a little bit. Maybe I want to do 30% power when I'm doing that. And I can say create new layer. As you can see, everything is defaulting to what I just did, except for this. So I'm going to say no thickness, and it's not etch anymore. It's kind of like a cut line. It's not cut through. So I'm just going to say line blue, and this is going to then be line blue stuff. As you can see, we've got two different subcategories. Typically, I don't call this line blue and etch blue. I would have these both under an etch parameter. So I'm going to change this by coming down here and saying edit description and switch this back to etch and click OK. By doing this, it's going to group these together. When I come into my library, I'll have all my different types of material. And if I'm going to be etching on stuff, I just say, stuff is what I want and what colors maybe I have underneath here. And if I'm doing etching on blue stuff, then I'll have a couple more parameters. Let's create a different kind of parameter on here. Many times when I am doing a fill, let's just get this back to the same parameters that we had, which I can't remember what they are. So let's do this. Let's assign my blue stuff back to there. Okay. And this is how we do the fill. What I'm going to come and do is I'm going to add a sublayer so that I'm going to do two different kinds of operations at the same time. This one is going to be line. I'm going to keep the same power or the same speed, but the power then is going to be at the higher percentage. So I'll do 30. And I can make a bunch of other changes, but just for simplicity. And what I would normally do with something like this is it would fill in. And then once it was done, it will then trace around that. It works particularly well when you're doing text and some, text that's smaller, let's say etching on a business card, that sort of thing. Doing this little extra line around the edge tidies it up just a little bit. So we'll say OK. And then look, our mode now is multi. Speed and power is multi. And I'm going to come down here and say create new from layer. Again, stuff is the material, no thickness. I'm going to say, yep, etch blue stuff. But this time, instead of saying line blue stuff, I'm going to call this etch with line blue stuff. Actually, that should probably go in my title, shouldn't it? We'll call that etch slash line and then click OK. Well, then now it's in its own subgroup. I changed my mind again. No, don't duplicate, cancel. Let's get rid of that one. Yes. I want to edit the description. We'll leave this. There we go. And then the description will be etch with line blue stuff. Now we have all three of these underneath blue stuff. So the next time I do something with blue stuff, there it is. Another potential is I have blue stuff and I want to be able to cut through it. And I'll maybe have my parameters. Let's say it's 300 millimeters per minute and 75% power. That happened to be what worked well for cutting through this. You know, one pass. Do I have any, curve? No, I'm not going to do any curve. Do I want to do a pause at the beginning or the end? Do I want to do an overcut? All of these parameters can be set. I'll go ahead and click OK. And let's create a new layer where material is going to be stuff, but this time I'm going to have a thickness. I'm going to say it's 1.5 millimeters. And the description is going to be cut blue stuff and click OK. So now underneath my stuff, I have etching parameters and I have cutting parameters. If I have another thickness of stuff that I want to work with, I would put in its parameters, maybe 200 at 80% power, and I have to do two passes. Go ahead and click OK, create from layer. This time it's, say, 2.5 millimeter. I'll still keep cut blue stuff for the description and material name is stuff. Click OK. So as you can see, we're starting to build up a library where I have different parameters set for different thicknesses when I'm cutting And if I want to etch on it, I have different parameters. If what I was doing with stuff was doing an image, then I would want to have another setting for that. Again, the only way to set that is to bring an image in. So let's do that real quickly. Let me go see if I can grab an image and bring that in. Here we have an image. This is going to be for a future project. I just happen to have it here. And in the future project, I'm going to do a trace on this and turn this into a vector. That way I don't have this little brick background. This will allow me to get this set up for doing image in my library. So I would go underneath my parameters and make sure they're set the way that I need them to be. So maybe 3000 again, and images work well at, again, this is information that you would get from testing. I'm going to say not 35%. I'll have air assist on. This is, oh, and the scan angle, I want to do it 0. I like using Jarvis dithering. So 1 pass. So these are the parameters that I want to use. I'll go ahead and click OK. And now I can create new from layer. Again, we're doing stuff and we're etching on there. This time, instead of cut, I'm going to say image and click OK. Now we have 4 different ways that we can do etching. You'll notice that the icon is different for these. When you're doing a line, it will do it as this little outlined thing. If you're doing an image, it's this little picture icon. When you're etching or doing the fill, then it uses this little fill thing. It's just like the line, but filled in. So you have a visual to let you know what you're doing. Anytime you select one of these, you can go in and edit the description of it. So you can change the name if you need to or want to. You can also change the cut parameters. Maybe you've found out that's like, well, the image doesn't really work as well as I thought it did. Or you want it to be a little bit darker, so you've decided, yeah, it's going to be 45% on the power, everything else is the same. Click OK. And now this is set. And we can see that by double-clicking on it, it brings up that's what the parameter is. I can also assign that to my layer, and everything gets set up here as well. I can duplicate, so if there's a couple different ways I want to do this, maybe I want to have an image light and an image dark. I could duplicate that. And so here we have the title and we have image, and this will be image. Put my hands in the right place. Image light blue stuff. And we'll get rid of copy, say OK. And if we go into the parameters, the light one is going to be the 35% power. And then we can update the name of this. So I'm going to come down here and say edit description and call this image dark blue stuff. And then my parameters will be in there for doing a light or a dark etch. This is all what you get to decide how you want this organized. Once you've created or started a library, then you'll want to save it so that when you come into this laser, that you can bring those libraries in. A library will be assigned or associated to a specific laser. You just want to make sure that you save that somewhere that you know where it is. I'm not going to do that right now because this isn't real information. You also have the option of switching over to different libraries. Right now, the location of my libraries is not turned on. I have another computer that stores that information. Let me go turn that on and show you what a full library or a more full library looks like. And here we have all the different kinds of materials from acrylic to wood. We've got plywood. We've got gum of all the weird things. Big red gum apparently etches. I have some parameters for that. But this is what your library will start to look like as you add things to it. The other library that we have is the art library, and it works in a different way. It's basically just a repository for images. If I were to load in my art library, we'd see that there are several different ones. So let's go ahead and do that. Here are all the different art libraries that I have available that I've made. We'll open that up. It'll take a moment for them to come in. And then there's just a variety of different images in each one of these. Fancy lines, dragons, computers, that sort of thing. And these can be vector images, they can be JPEGs, PNG, all sorts of different things can be in your library. One of the things that I found that I really like to do is take something like this tree. Maybe I want that underneath flowers. That would be a kind of a weird place. Let's not do a flowers. Let's just create a new art library. I'll just click new. It'll ask me where it goes. It's going to be with the rest of these. I'm going to call this one tree. This is going to be my tree art library. And there's currently nothing in it. I can just select this image and I can say import graphic from project. Simple as that. Give it a name. Round tree image. And click OK. And here we have that. And I can double click it or drag it onto a project anytime I want. So I can just double click and here it is in the project. What I like to do on an image such as this is I want to trace it. I want to turn it into a vector. So I'll come in and tell it that I want to do a trace image. And looking at this, it's doing a fantastic job at the default settings. It's not getting any of the bricks, just getting the tree. I'll go ahead and click OK. And let's put this on a real material. Let's put this on plywood cut through. We'll assign that. See what that looks like. Maybe we'll do a fill so we can see it better. In any regard, it is a vector at this point. And what I can do is I can select this and I can add that to my library. So in here, when I say import graphic, what it'll bring in now is the vector drawing. So I can say round tree vector. And then now I have both of those in here. So the next time I want to do one of these, if I want to do it as a vector, I can just double click that, bring it in, resize it to whatever size I need, and I'm all set to go. I could also bring in the actual tree drawing if for some reason I wanted to do the tree drawing. Well, this is a great way to build up a library of stuff. Just bring in images as you use them. If you think you'll ever use them again, do that. And here's some pictures of a few things that I've really not used much. Under dragons, I have used this quite a bit. Where's the dragon that I've used? I've used this dragon on a few occasions, as well as some of the others. The fancy line, I use some of these fairly frequently. Recently, I'd used the computer one. So there's just things that fit your needs. That's what you want to put in there. I hope this was a nice quick explanation of how these two different libraries work. The nice thing about the art library is that it saves automatically, so I don't have to save it every time like I do with the material library. I've gotten caught where I've forgotten to save this, I've closed off the project, and I've lost a parameter, but typically pretty easy to get those back. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you like the content of our channel, think about subscribing, as that really helps us out. Enjoy doing your CNC at home projects. Chocolate thin mints. Oh, I should do that again. Those were pretty good.
Oops.
Okay, that's gonna suck. I think I just overwrote my library.